we started flying, and on a sixth mission, which was October the 14th, we went up to bomb a synthetic oil refinery, the Odertal oil refinery, which was located in southern Poland in the area where Auschwitz was located. In fact, whenever the, after the oil refineries, there's another one up there, the Odertal and Blackhammer was the other one. After they were damaged, they would take the slave labor from Auschwitz to repair the damage that we had done to get it back into production again. But we were damaged, and we couldn't keep up with the bomb group after we dropped the bombs, and we ended up being by ourselves, and we were losing altitude, and we stripped everything out of the plane to try to stay in the air, and we're using up our lost gas somehow, because when we were heading back to Italy again, and when we got in around Yugoslavia, it became apparent we were going to get back to Italy. So we in the our rec room on the wall, there was a map of Europe, and it showed the fields of fire of all the anti-aircraft guns that they knew in Europe, and the number and fields of fire, and also in Yugoslavia, it was color coded. Different areas had different color codes, and they indicated the probability, the percent probability of being picked up by friendly people. And I studied that a lot, and working with the navigator, we picked a point to jump out over Yugoslavia, and it turned out that it was a very good point, because when I jumped out of the plane, I was the first one out because I was the youngest, and the crew wasn't too sure that if they left me behind that I'd jump out. But anyway, when I bailed out, I pulled my ripcord, and I couldn't feel any jerk or anything. And I thought, I looked, and there was no parachute there. And I thought maybe the pins that held the parachute pack together were bent or something. So then I pulled with two hands, and I got a big jerk, and came down into a bottom of a sinkhole that had very high ferns, and I took off my parachute. And by the way, they have in the other room, they have a the pilot chute from that parachute, and also we eventually brought back the parachute to Italy, and a scarf that was made from a piece of that parachute. And when I took off my helmet, I started going up the side of this hole, and I could hear voices on the top. And first thing I saw coming at me was a group of women and children. And I looked around the whole perimeter of the hole, and directly on the other side, there were a pretty good force of armed men heading in the same direction. So I thought I'd have to keep them from taking a shot at me. So I made sure I was lined up between a men and a women, so that it would be kind of dangerous. And I went and approached the women, and I said I was an American. And I also had a identification that had the American flag on it and my photograph, and in about six or eight languages of the southern European area, it said that I was an American airman, to ask them to help me, you know, to get away from. And they they said that there was a German garrison down in a valley near where we came down, and they probably would be sending up patrols to look for us. And so they said, come on, and they took me to a barn, and one of our other crew members was already in that barn, and they told us to take off our flying clothing, and they took that, and they made up a two-wheeled ox cart with hay in the freight area, or whatever you want to call it, and with one ox to pull it. And they put our clothing underneath the hay, and then we sat on like the tailboard of that, the two of us. And the patrol of partisans went down to the first curve in the road, and another patrol went up on a hill that overlooked everything. And they both signaled by hand that it was okay to proceed, and they kept on leapfrogging ahead, and we kept on going on that road. And we're gradually going uphill, and 3 days later, we ended up in a town called Sanski Most. When we got into the town, within 3 days, the rest of our crew also got into the town, and there were 45 airmen who were in that town. What was going on? And a few days after we were in there, we went at night. We went out to the meadow, and the we could walk around the town freely. It was crawling with just these partisans, and everybody was armed, including the women. And you'd see the women walking around with ammunition belts, you know, down here, and a couple of hand grenades hanging off of their waist, and all of them wore German uniforms with the insignia removed, and I assumed that they had raided the Germans or killed the Germans in order to get the clothing that they were wearing, including the women walked around with hobnail boots and everything. But we went out to this meadow, and the radio man brought a set along with him, and soon it was dark, and soon we heard engines overhead. And he got on a radio, and he identified it as a friendly. And the partisans, there was a big contingent of partisans had come along, and they had lined themselves up about the width of a runway apart in two rows. And when a partisan commander shouted that it was okay, that it was friendly over their head, they lit up torches. And the plane landed in between the torches. As soon as it passed each torch, it was extinguished, right, you know, right as soon. And when it came to stop, it was a C-47, and it could only hold 21 men. So there were 45 of us in the Sanski Most at that time. So they went by the ones who were either injured or sick, and then by seniority. And so I didn't get out on that first plane. It took me three planes to get out, and that was several weeks later because of weather conditions. The ground would be too soft, or the weather wasn't good enough.